Brenda. Thank you, choir. Good morning.
Good morning.
Beloved of Christ, happy Sabbath. Happy Sunday, Pilgrim Saints of Westdale United Church. It's wonderful to see your beautiful, shining faces as we gather in the Spirit of the Lord. Welcome and thank you so much for being here today. I invite you to join with me in our welcoming. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
How glorious it is to worship in this cathedral of God's grace. Made as creative and wonder-filled people, you are a child of God, a blessing, a seeker, a disciple, growing in God's grace planted within you. We have gathered aware of God's presence flowing from one person to another. You have brought the Spirit with you. So each one of you are a gift, chosen and loved by God. Created in the holy image, each one of you are wonderfully made. So be still and listen to the day. Touch the breeze of the Spirit with the quiet in your soul. For Jesus welcomes you here just as you are, graces you with an unconditional love, a peaceful rest, and a yoke that is easy and light. Here we are, the family of God, welcomed by the Spirit of Christ and held by God's grace. Ordinary people, called to be the holy people of God. So relax in the Spirit. Jesus said that the Spirit is like the wind moving and unpredictable. It stirs us and stirs within us and lifts us up, fills our sails and lifts our hearts. So sway with the music, be captured by prayer. With the God of light and glory, the God of wondrous love, we take our place in the chorus of praise. Let us worship the source of love and life who created you. For this is the day that the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. I invite you to join with me as we... What a beautiful slide. Reading a wonderful book by the late Richard Wagamese, who was an Ojibwe elder, theologian, I would say. He wrote a book called One Drum. And he talks about it in the book that the need of the hour is unity. Unity is the great need of the hour, he says. And he believes that there is a time. This is the time where we will all gather around the one light to be united, where we will no longer focus on our differences, but on what brings us together. An understanding of all peoples who walk upon this land are one song, he says, and one drum. And so when we recognize this land as First Nations lands, we also celebrate a culture and a people who unite us in their understanding of who God is and who we are. And so I invite you to join with me. Westdale United Church is situated on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Mississauga, and the land covered by the Williams Treaty.
We respectfully acknowledge and honor First Nation people's history, spirituality, and stewardship of this land, wherein our place of worship resides.
You are the body of Christ on this holy ground, a holy ground, a holy place, a holy people. We gather around the light of Christ, which unites us all. And so I invite you to join with me as we light our Christ candle. In Christ, God says to us,
"Arise, shine, for your light has come."
Lighting a candle is a prayer for courage. As it shines, may our prayers be heard. Hope has come into the world.
Joy has come into the world. Eternal light shines in our hearts.
We are your children.
We carry your light within us.
This candle is a beacon of love to show us the way. The light of Christ. The light of the world, the light within you. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you.
says that God has made his home within us. Paul says we are the temple in which the Spirit of Christ now dwells. I invite you to join with me in our call to worship. Amazing God of amazing grace, you light up our thoughts, our lives, with the wonder of your call.
We shall praise God together. Like the birds ending in this nest, we gather.
Like the first star of the night appearing, we gather.
All that is eternal in us welcomes the wonder of this day.
Raise your voice and join with me.
We shall praise God together.
Share your stories. Love your neighbor. Understand in new ways the gifts of God to us all.
Move the sky and move the sea.
Breathe the grass and field and forest.
God, sunlight, glow of hearts.
See the colors dance together. Lift your hearts and sing for joy.
In the colors of creation, we see God's glory.
See God's goodness. Lift your heart.
Sing for joy.
Hold still. Let the Spirit rest upon us. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, partner on our journey, creator of light, spark of divine love, God of light and glory, God of wondrous love, we take our place in the chorus of praise. Bright and holy God, you move among us when we gather in your name, which is love, in hope, in peace, in joy. So we gather together around your light of love and hope and peace and joy. We gather at the door of the light-filled dawn, where the gift of hope rises in our soul, for your glory fills this place. This is a day of new beginnings. Give us bread for our journey. Unite us in a creative love. Let the peace of this place surround us. Let the hurry and worry from our week fall away. God of grace and God of glory, take our lives and inspire them. Prepare us for mysteries that can change us. Ready us for dreams that send us in new directions. Dance down and meet us here at the sacred well of our faith. And give us hearts to see the things our eyes can overlook. Open our hearts to feel the things our hands can't touch. Open our hearts to hear the still, small voice, which sounds like only silence to our listening ears. God of splendor, God of glory, you who lit the stars above, write your love on our hearts today. Meet us here, so our lives might ignite a love to light the world. In all this we pray in Jesus' name, whose voice is our strength, and whose breath is the spirit of peace. Amen. Amen. It's wonderful to see some children in church today, and so we're going to split our first hymn, or opening hymn, the children's hymn, Immortal, Invisible God, Only Wise. So we'll sing a couple verses, and the children will invite to join me up here at the front, and then afterwards they'll go out and they'll join Janice, who's teaching Sunday school today. So I'm looking forward to that. I invite you to lift up your voices.
Immortal, invisible God, only wise, in light, in excess, above and from. see you.
Great. Wow. How are you doing? How was your week?
Good.
You had a good week at school?
Yes.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. You had a good Thanksgiving?
Yes.
Yeah. Did you eat that pineapple last Sunday? Or the orange? You like the orange, wasn't it? Yes. Last Sunday we talked about how God works in us by the Spirit, eh? Which is like the wind and beautiful stirring within us that grows things and plants seeds and all that fruit, eh? The pineapple and the orange. I remember you liked the orange. Good for you. The fruit is good for us, eh? Took all the fruit? Yes? Yep. Some of the things are fruit that we didn't know, eh? Pumpkin and tomato and all kinds of things with seeds. Anything with a seed that grows into a flower, like us, eh? And from that flower comes this wonderful fruit, eh? And yeah. So you're going to hear me talk a lot about how God is with us always, eh? I look out at this beautiful congregation. I see all these beautiful, shiny faces. And, I see God. I see God. Somebody the other day asked me, they said, what does God look like? What does God look like? And I thought, wow, that's a good question. And I thought, you know what God looks like? Do you know what God looks like?
No.
No? What if you look in this mirror? Oh. Is that what God looks like? Yeah. God looks like that. Eh? God looks like us. The Bible says we're created in the image of God, eh? We're a reflection of God, eh? What do you think that means? Kind of a big question, isn't it, eh? What does God look like? What does... Yeah. Okay. You're shy this week. I'll have to bring oranges in. Next week. Yeah. So, that's all right. Yep. I got long arms. Yeah. What do you think that means, eh? We can be the image of God, reflection of God, eh?
I don't know what.
Yeah. Yeah. So when we take care of each other, eh? Love each other and be kind to each other, eh? We can reflect the image of God. Eh? And going to church helps us to see that in each other. You know, this week, you notice anything different? Any different when I got new glasses. I don't know if I like them or not yet, but I think I look like Harry Potter. But, I think I might be too old to look like Harry Potter. But somebody said I look like a professor. I said, well, I look smart, but I'm... I guess there's a one. Okay, it looks... But yeah, if I got new glasses, now I can see a little clearer. Hey, yeah. So we come to church to help each other see each other, see God in each other. And there's different ways to remind us of that. Hey, we light the Christ candle at the beginning of the service, and so we talk about how the fruit of the Spirit. God is Spirit, like the wind, and God is like light as well. What does light do for us? Hey, why don't you turn the lights on? I slept with a nightlight till I was 12 years old. I was scared of the dark. That little bit of light kind of broke the darkness. And now I'm okay with the dark, but it's the light, eh? Yeah, the light. And the days are getting a little shorter. It's getting darker earlier, but the leaves are brighter. And it's so we see this, eh, breaking the darkness. So light, eh? We light. Bob, make sure the lights are on, and we light a candle. That's the light within us, and I sent away for something. I thought it was a flashlight. I couldn't. Can you get that to light? Oh, you figured it out. That's it, eh? You got to touch both ends, and it makes a circuit and a little bit of electricity, and it goes all the way around you. Yeah. Here. You hold that in, maybe with your other hand, and you hold sister's hand. And maybe you could hold your grandmother's hand.
Oh.
Need a reach? Yeah, and we're all about to do things with her. Everybody could hold hands here.
God, your word is a lamp to our feet
and
loving God.
You speak to us in so many ways.
Speak to us in the beating of our hearts.
In the stirring of our spirits.
Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love.
We may hear what you are saying to us today.
May the light of Christ's truth fill our minds.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
God in community, holy and one. Amen. So the gospel today is St. Matthew 22, 1-14, and in the large Bible it is found on 1174. Once again, Jesus used stories to teach the people. The kingdom of heaven is like what happened when a king gave a wedding banquet for his son. The king sent some servants to tell the invited guests to come to the banquet. But the guests refused. He sent other servants to say to the guests, "The banquet is ready. My cattle and prized calves have been prepared. Everything is ready. Come to the banquet." But the guests did not pay any attention. Some of them left for their farms, and some went back to their places of business. Others grabbed the servants, then beat them up and killed them. This made the king so furious that he sent an army to kill those murderers and burn down their city. Then he said to the servants, "It is time for the wedding banquet, and the invited guests don't deserve to come. Go out to the street corners and tell everyone you meet to come to the banquet." They went out onto the streets and brought in everyone they could find, good and bad alike. And the banquet room was filled with guests. When the king went in to meet the guests, he found that one of them wasn't wearing the right kind of clothes for the wedding. The king asked, "Friend, why didn't you wear proper clothes for the wedding?" But the guest had no excuse. So the king gave orders for that person to be tied hand and foot and to be thrown outside into the dark. That's where people will cry and grit their teeth in pain. Many are invited, but only a few are chosen. This is the good news of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Thanksgiving and also on Thursday for choir practice, I decided to listen to an anthem. So it's now time for your favorite hymns. So if anybody has a favorite, we're going to sing three hymns, two verses of each of the hymns. So, 402.
Oh,
favorite hymns, and also having the congregation join in the prelude and the postlude today. And that is because our cantata practices are starting on Thursday. And if you would like to be part of the cantata, it's a commitment until December 17th. So every Thursday from 7 till 8 is cantata practice. And we welcome all singers. You were singing very beautifully today. So you can let your light shine through singing with the Christmas cantata.
Woodstock, all around there, and Todd said it was a bit of a blur. I remember he had flown in. He had a red eye the night before, and he had just flown in for the wedding, and I made him a coffee in the office, and it's a beautiful wedding. Both were married before, both had children from before, they were all involved. I presided at a lot of weddings. I've had the gift of celebrating a lot of covenants and a lot of love. I attended many as a guest, and they were all different. Every one of them was different and unique. I remember going to an Italian wedding in a big Catholic church in Toronto, and there were over 400 people there in that big church, and it was still only the third full. And I presided at weddings in little wooden white churches in the Maritimes, where speakers had to be put outside in the back of trucks. There were so many people. And the windows were often painted shut. That's one of the things I noticed here at Westdale. I thought you could actually open the windows here. But in the Maritimes, these little white wooden churches with all the painted, and hot. So I've seen big churches, I've seen little weddings. I had a December wedding. It was December the 23rd. And the bride was 8 months pregnant. And she was just glowing. Just glowing. She had to get the ring resized because her fingers. And she was so happy. And there was a meter of snow the night before, and a lot of folks worked hard with shovels to make that celebration happen. She looked so beautiful in the snow, all the pictures. I remember where I lived in Cape North, around the Cabot Trail. The tradition there was that everyone in the village got invited to the wedding. Literally everybody. It was an open invitation to anybody. And then the reception was just those who were invited. Then after the reception, there was a big dance. And then everybody was invited again to that. I remember a wedding on a beach. The whole village came out, and then afterwards a dinner, and then the local hockey arena was full of dancing neighbors. I think nobody was home in all of Cape North that night. I remember the Sunday after weddings, there weren't very many people in church. Those who were there were half asleep. Weddings, everybody was invited. And it didn't matter what you wore. My mother has a picture of me as a little boy, about 7 or 8, with my dad's tie, and my sister is there. And I remember, I think I was the only little boy in the community, or in the neighborhood in Windsor, and we always played wedding for some reason. I married my sister 3 dozen times, I think. And 25 years later, I actually got to preside at her wedding in my parents' backyard. I married Isabel and Alina, 2 little girls next door, and then I never got married myself after that. I mean, I don't know what that was about, but I got married dozens of times, and there was always ice cream afterwards, a party, a celebration, weddings. What a powerful image that Christ offers us. The kingdom of God is like a wedding. The king, who's obviously God, it's his son's wedding. Jesus invites people. But people don't seem to want to go. At least not at first. But he keeps on asking and asking and asking. And eventually the church is full. We meet a vulnerable God. When I was thinking about this parable this week, I was thinking about this is a vulnerable God who can only invite. Jesus tells us that of God, the King, can only invite people to attend the wedding of his son, Jesus, who is turning water into wine, despair into hope, breaking the darkness. God can't make anyone attend. God can only invite. And if you attend, you better make sure you're wearing the appropriate clothes. It's kind of a curious part, isn't it, that one guy didn't seem to get the message of what to wear. Kind of a strange parable, full of grace, full of expectation and calling. God can only invite. This week I had my car in to, I just bought a car, it's 5 years old, it's new to me, but it's, and the doors aren't locking. The doors are a strange problem to have. Nissan said this, we've never seen this before. I said, well, that's great, you know, great to have something that has never happened before, but, you know, the doors won't lock. So if you go to my car right now, you can pull the door and get in, and the doors won't lock. So anybody can get into my car, but not everybody can drive it. What a strange problem to have. The kingdom of God is like an unlocked door. Always unlocked. Jesus talks about the kingdom of God having a narrow door, but that door is always unlocked. Jesus meets a woman at a well. She has lived a troubled life, and besides, her God is different than his. The door is locked. She says her God lives on a different mountain. And they have nothing to talk about, and then something else happens. Jesus says God doesn't live on a mountaintop at all. God is spirit, and the spirit has brought them together. And then what does she do? She goes into town, and she invites everybody to the wedding. A prodigal son returns, make him work hard to earn your love again, and then something else happens instead. His father, who he wronged, throws a party and invites everybody to the wedding. A few weeks ago, the Faith Formation Committee delivered to Brenda and Bonnie and Molly, delivered 200 invitations to a wedding here at Westdale every Sunday, a relationship. Brenda donated these beautiful cards, these postcards, these invitations. You received one as well. And put them in people's doors and mailboxes, an invitation to something. Jesus called it a parable, which is almost the same thing as a dream. It's not a once and for all story. It's a story you can walk around in. A story that wants a response from you, hopes for a response from you. One that changes as you change. So that is different the 10th time you hear it than it is the first. Jesus was certainly looking for a response, but his reasons for recording the story don't exhaust our reasons for entering it. The king, the banquet, the dress code, the failure, the exposure of the failure, the judgment, the free fall into outer darkness. You know this story, don't you? It's about persistence. God keeps on inviting people to the party. Raymond Chandler, the British-American writer, says, down these mean streets, a man must go who is not himself mean, who is neither tarnished nor afraid. He is the hero. He is everything. He must be a complete man and a common man, and yet an unusual man. He must be, to use a rather weathered phrase, a man of honor, by instinct, by inevitability. Without thought of it, and certainly without saying it, he must be the best man in his world, and a good enough man for any world. Persistence. God will never leave us alone. See, God sends the Holy Spirit to push and shove and push and shove and invites us, and faith gives us imagination. The opposite of faith, I think, is not doubt. But rather, the opposite of faith is the inability to dream. It's not about fear at all. It's about being fearless, because you have something to give, and that something was a gift from God. But it's a challenging parable. It's only in the Gospel of Matthew. Remember, in seminary, the Gospel of Matthew was taught to us by a Jewish rabbi by the name of Herb Basser. He was a prison chaplain. And Herb Basser pointed out that in Matthew, it's never a good thing to be addressed as friend, he said. Every time somebody is called a friend in Matthew, what follows is not pleasant. Jesus himself was referred to as a friend by the religious authorities in Matthew 11, but it was no compliment. They accused Jesus of being a friend of tax collectors and sinners. In the parable of the laborers in the vineyard, the master of the vineyard overhears the grumbling and of the 12-hour workers over being paid the same as the one-hour workers? Am I not being unfair to you? Am I not being fair to you, friend? The master says. But there is an edge to that. The grumblers were no friends of the owner. Later in Matthew, we find the single most pointed such instance when, having been kissed by the traitor Judas, Jesus asks him, "Friend, what have you come for?" But a close second to that final devastating use of friend may well be here in Matthew 22, when a hapless wedding guest is addressed as friend, right before being most definitively thrown out on his ear. The center of this parable displays the reach of God's gospel to the least likely of people. The outsider is the theme in the Gospel of Matthew, and it has been hammering away at since his opening genealogy and then the appearance of the Magi. The outsider. It's fairly easy to see how and why this is finally a parable full of grace, but that grace is nestled in pretty closely to judgment as well. Kitchener, they found a bunker. It was a Cold War bunker across from the big hospital there, the Grand River Hospital. Might have to get Dennis to finish this. In this bunker, they found there was room for 39 beds, 5,000 square feet. I remember the question at the time was who would have been allowed in. It was built in 1966. Who was allowed in to this bunker and who was left out? Built in 1966 at the height of the Cold War, this 5,000 square foot bunker was designed to accommodate about 40 people for several weeks and had built-in heating and water and sewage and the shelter was to house certain people in the community, those who were deemed to have been necessary if there was a nuclear holocaust. Hey, I see my friend coming. Found this bunker in Kitchener, and that was the big question: was who was allowed in? Who would have been allowed in 1966? There's only room for 40 people in all of that area, so you had to be on a list. Who was invited? Government officials, staff, and engineers who would keep the Waterloo County government going in the event of a nuclear attack. That became the story about who got into the bunker. Just a select few. The other day I was at Walmart. It was about 20 to 10. It was closing at 10. And there was a young woman there pushing a cart full of things. The security guard and the manager, I would think, were sort of following her around and telling her, "You got to hurry up, we're closing soon, we're closing soon." Now, I had a cart full of things as well, and nobody was following me around. And she said, "This is racism, this is racism." And then they ushered her out, and I thought to myself, she's not wearing the right clothes. I talked to her afterwards in the parking lot, and she was looking for a toy for her daughter. We're all invited to the wedding. We're all invited into this relationship built on grace. And grace is love doing something. Sister Stephanie, it was almost her job to say grace when we had supper. And we had a little house in Windsor on Alexis and near Chrysler. And there was three of us. And in the kitchen, there were a kitchen table basically filled the kitchen. There was a stove and a counter and a table. So we had to pull this out every time we had a meal together. My brother always got to sit in behind. And that was our routine. We would pull it out, my dad and I. My brother would sit in behind. We had this round table, this oval table. Then after supper, we'd push it back in. And my mother said, I always had a habit of inviting my friend to supper right in front of my mother. Can my friend stay for supper? Like right in front of her. I knew she couldn't say no then. So there was almost more people. And we had a leaf that made the table even bigger. There was always room. Always room. And we always ate together. Maybe the parable is about realizing that we are all sitting at the same table. That we are all in line together, all waiting in the marketplace, waiting for a chance. There is a grace in that, a love that is doing something. From this parable, I think Jesus wants us to see three things. First, the gates of the kingdom of God are open wide. They may be narrow, but they're open, unlocked. Everyone is invited to the wedding. Second, though the gates of the kingdom are open wide, the kingdom still has gates, and so we must enter through them. The kingdom imposes conditions on us. We must bear its fruits. We have a particular kind of clothing to wear to the feast. In the words of St. Paul, we must put on, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, and kindness and humility. Most of all, love. And finally, we mustn't miss the point. The kingdom of God is a feast. It's joyful, a celebration. And so we should act like it is. God means for us to enjoy life. He is the God of laughter, and full bellies, and second helpings. In his presence, says King David, there is fullness of joy. Do you believe that? If you do, then come, Jesus says, because there's a seat with your name on it. To God be the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. I invite you to lift up your voices and join in singing, All Creatures of Our God and King. trust and hope. You are the potter, and we are the clay, the work of your hands. You have made us in your image, into your likeness. You have shaped us and continue to shape us. Stand with us in this hopeful place. We give you thanks for this beautiful church. Stand with us, that we might expect great things from you and attempt great things for you. So we may show to the world you sent Jesus to heal the world. Thy kingdom come. You have given us prayers to pray, scripture to read, worship to love. You have given us tasks to do, friends to love, people to invite, a world to live in and learn from. So we offer our hands and our feet and our minds, love through us. And help us to hold to the truth which you have offered us this day, that we are loved and guided and invited by your Spirit, that life is a gift to celebrate and share. Ever guiding Spirit, open us to the path that you call us to travel. Oh God, you see us as you call us to be. You call us to sing and dance, to shout and proclaim. You call us to be your friend, to be your love in the world. Oh God, mysterious and encouraging, you have a mission for this place. Place your song in our hearts and help us to sing it into the world. Give us this day our daily bread, wondrous God. You love this world into being. Amazing God, amaze us, touch our lives, and cast your sunlight till rainbows rise. Plant dreams like furrows in the ground, rekindling hope, reviving our strength, energizing our faith. Eager to dance according to your melody, take from us what burdens we carry. Repair what is broken. White heart of love, you love us. You are our friend, you know us, you challenge the darkness. Patient presence, thank you for keeping the porch light on to welcome us home. Let your peace enter the hearts of those facing challenges this day. We are bold in our prayers for peace in our world, peace in Gaza and Israel, in Ukraine. God of the listening heart, we pause now in the silence within us or spoken aloud and name before you those who we carry with us today, those we love. Inspire us, O God, on our journey to bring light to the world. Let friendship and wonder grow, be our hope, be our love, move us beyond the edge of our dreams. Where friendship and a listening ear are needed, may we offer grace in the Spirit of Christ. And may we never be hasty in judgment and always generous. For we make our prayer through the one who walked on water, fed thousands, and calls us each by name. Jesus, our friend, the one who taught us to pray in one spirit, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be
thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into
Canadian Food Grains Bank. It's the 40th anniversary of the Canadian Food Grains Bank. The United Church of Canada has been a partner of the Food Grains Bank with 15 other churches, the Mennonite Central Committee and the Anglican Church of Canada. The United Church is a huge partner in that. It's a church-based agency working together to end hunger around the world.
Hello, I'm the Right Reverend Dr. Carmen Lansdowne, moderator of the United Church of Canada. Ending global hunger and working to stabilize global food security has never been more important than during this time of inflation and skyrocketing food prices. The effects of world hunger are as diverse as they are devastating, and unfortunately, we are moving farther away from attaining this ultimate goal of ending global hunger. The United Church of Canada is honored to be a member of the Canadian Food Grains Bank, a partnership of 15 church and church-based agencies working together to end global hunger. The Food Grains Bank community is celebrating 40 years of living into God's mission of life, dignity, and abundance for all. Through engagement in growing projects, learning tours, government advocacy, and support of mission and service, many of you have been part of these last 40 years. We want to thank you for all your support and accompaniment of global partners, the Food Grains Bank, and the United Church. We are so grateful that we can all work together towards the common goal of ending global hunger. Thank you for 40 years of prayers, your good acts, and your generosity. May God bless you and those around you, and may we continue to commit our support for those facing hunger.
Always look up. But, yeah, so it's from, that's Saturday the 4th, looking forward to that. Men's breakfast is coming up October the 29th, and that's 8:30. So we ask for a $5 donation for the mission and service fund if you're able to do that. And the wonderful book club is coming up October 27th. Lots of wonderful things happening in October. The Westdale Social, this is going to be fun. October the 27th, a Friday, 7 to 9 at Ross and Kathy's place. Westdale Bowling, Sunday, October the 22nd at 2 p.m. And you see the prices there, $17 and $15, and so two games and shoes. Pickleball, a hugely popular sport, and the great pickleball players here at Westdale. That's Friday evening, so there's a bunch of dates there. And so this Friday, starting this Friday, the Wii U group was rescheduled for tomorrow. So we went from October 2nd to the 16th. A couple of the young people were a little bit under the weather, so it's moved to one tomorrow. So, yeah. Is there anything else? Anything else you want to announce? Friday we had our movie night, our first movie for Mission. Fall of the Forest, The Forgotten Wisdom of Trees. So there were seven of us, and people brought socks and mitts and things like that, warm things. So, but I'm going to put this in the church's library. You have a beautiful library here, full of lots of wonderful books and videos. And so I'm going to put this video, this movie here, this DVD, if you'd like to borrow that. The Call of the Forest. So that'll be in there. If you didn't make it out to the movie, you could borrow that. So. Picture. I want you to lift up your voices and join in singing All Things Bright and Beautiful. Small. Children of God, friends of Jesus, people of heart and spirit, go boldly into the world with a daring and tender love. Go from here with open arms, with heads held high, with love in your hearts, for each one of you are beautiful and loved by God. May the God of our glorious music keep your hearts singing. In hope we are born, in partnership we are called, in love we live, in faith we go. You are the message. You are the good news. Be the message. Do the message. Live the message. Reach out like Christ and touch the world. And carry the light of Christ with you. Be the eyes that see the holy in all people, and the heart that is full of life. And may that light in your soul guide you, and may you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet, and may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. Amen.